midst of Carmel, who dwell in the midst of Carmel, who dwell in the midst of Carmel. Be thy people with the rod of flock of the heritage, who dwells olive tailed in the wood, in the midst of Carmel, who dwell 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 in the midst of Carmel.
From this Sunday, we are going to have a series of devotion from the Bible, as we have done many other times. Grace to you. It's a great burden that the Lord has given in my heart to speak to the church and to create a doctrine on grace. Because we are living in the last days, where the teachings of the Bible are perverted, people are talking about grace, hyper-grace, as a license that we have got to lead a life that suits us. So I love to talk to you about grace continually for a few more weeks. Last night, maybe very late evening, we put a web banner on this morning's message. I received a few comments, and one of the comments, again from one of my friends, he is from a very staunch Hindu background. By studies, he was a lawyer, but he joined the banking sector. He got retired as a senior manager of one of the leading nationalized banks. He has posted a comment last night, past midnight, after seeing this web banner. "Robert, I need the grace of Lord Jesus Christ. Please pray for me specifically." God bless him. We all need the grace of the Lord. We all need the grace of the Lord. Glory be to the Lord's holy name. So before I could get into the Word of God, can anybody tell me, without seeing the Bible, what is the last verse in our Bible? Anybody? "The grace of the Lord be with us forever and ever." Amen. Probably the last word was right. Amen. The last verse, I really appreciate the attempt she made. "The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all." The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. That is the last verse in the Bible. Grace to you. The first occurrence in the Bible, the word grace, is in Genesis chapter 6 verse 8. Genesis chapter 6 verse 8. "But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord." But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. That's the first occurrence of the word grace. In the New Testament, again almost a similar situation, the first occurrence is in Luke chapter 1 verse 30, at the Annunciation of Mary. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor. In the original and in the other translation, thou hast found grace with God. In the book of Noah, when God was starting his work with mankind, his mercy of salvation to save people with his divine plan, Noah found grace in the eyes of God. In the New Testament, God was starting his work to save people. Mary found grace in the eyes of the Lord. But before that, how does that Old Testament ends? So that we can, it's only an introduction this morning. We can see how the Old Testament ends. In Zechariah chapter 12 verse 10, the history of Israel was coming to an end. And I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplications. That's after the church is taken away. The Israelites are living by law. They are making law more important than grace. But after the church is raptured, the spirit of grace will be given unto them. The spirit of grace will be given unto them. And before that, again in Zechariah chapter 4 verse 7, Zechariah chapter 4:7, they are reconstructing the temple in the days of Zerubbabel. There was not much to, that there were not many to help him. At the time this prophecy came, there was a great task before him. Who art thou, O great mountain? The task of building the temple in Jerusalem. Who art thou, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, thou shalt become a plain. This task would become very simple, very plain. This would become a chapa matter. And he shall bring forth the headstone. Zerubbabel shall bring forth the headstone thereof with shoutings, crying, Grace, grace unto it. Grace, grace unto it. Not by might, not by strength, but by the Spirit of God. The task will be over. This is how the grace is pictured there. In the New Testament, in the Pauline epistles and the general epistles, we find the word grace many times. Many times. Nearly 100 times. Or to be specific, if I'm right, 99 times more. But in the book of Revelation, you don't read about grace. It's the book of judgment. In the book of Revelation, you don't read about any of the works of grace. Only two references are in the book of Revelation on grace. One is in chapter 4, verse 4. The other one is the last verse. In both these verses, grace is given only a form of salutation. In chapter 1, verse 4, Grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come. A normal salutation. Grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come. And again in the last chapter, as a salutation, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. We don't find grace at all in the book of Revelation. These are the days of grace. Then come the days of judgment. There comes the days of judgment. Nothing about grace is said in the book of Revelation. In chapter 1 verse 4, chapter 22 verse 21, only in the normal salutation the word grace is used. My dear brother, my dear sister, the English word grace is found 170 times in the Bible. 170 times in the Bible. And out of that, 39 times in the Old Testament, 131 times in the New Testament, but not in the book of Revelation. Only twice in the book of Revelation, chapter 1 and chapter 22. The salutation, the prologue, in the salutation, the epilogue, not in that book, not in the main writings. Chapter 1, first 8 verses are prologue. Chapter 22 from verse 6, epilogue. Munnurai mudivurai. Only in these two places you find the word grace, not in the book of Revelation. My dear brother, my dear sister, we have to be very careful about it. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. So in this first lesson on this series of grace to you, I love to show unto you the primary words used for grace in the Hebrew and Greek versions. Hebrew and Greek versions. In Hebrew, the word chem, C-H-E-N, chem, it is used. That word is used for 69 times and it is translated in English, grace, 39 times. And in all the other times it is translated as favor, loving kindness, etc. In the New Testament, the Greek word charis, C-H-A-R-I-S, C-H-A-R-I-S, charis. That word is used for 156 times. And more than 130 times it is translated as grace, and a few times gracious, one or two times favor. But mostly that word is translated as grace or gracious. So we should understand what do we mean by Hebrew ken or Greek charis, so that to some extent we can understand what is exactly meant by grace. And we shall know whether we have got grace or not. So grace basically means, yesterday I was spending many hours intensively to bring a proper definition of those words. Many times only when we understand those words or what those words mean, then we can go into it. We can go into it. So what does this word charis, or what does this word ken mean? Grace basically means charm. Charmy boy, charmy girl, charm. Grace, charis basically means charm. From that we get charisma. He's a charismatic leader. It's a charismatic speech. Charisma. It, hence, from here, also means, it, hence, also means beautiful, attractive, lovable, good to look at, etc. The gracious walk of a lion, we say. The walk of a lion, the majestic, is very attractive, is lovable, is beautiful. Gracious walk of a lion. Gracious dance of a peacock. Gracious dance of a peacock. In the invitations, we put come and grace the occasion. Your very presence adds beauty, adds glory, adds happiness to that occasion. Come and grace the occasion. the gracious look of that person. He spoke gracious words. His words are gracious. Very lovable words. Very charming words. His words have got a charismatic power. It can pull others. So basically, grace means charm, charisma, beauty, attractive. There's a literal meaning, a basic meaning of grace. But when we say God's grace, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, what do we mean by grace of the Lord? Or the Lord's grace? The beauty He gives to us. So God's grace is that which affords joy, pleasure, delight, sweetness, charm, loveliness of the merciful kindness by which God, exerting His holy and divine influence upon our souls. It is out of His mercy. It is out of His mercy. God inputs, God exerts a type of a holy and divine influence in our life. It is God's doing. God is doing, out of His holy divine influence, He exerts a holy and divine influence upon our souls. That affords joy, pleasure, delight, sweetness, charm, loveliness, everything. It's all out of His merciful kindness He imparts in our soul. So what does that do? That grace, when He imparts or He exerts grace in our soul, that turns us to Christ, it keeps us, strengthens us, increases in us the Christian faith, knowledge, affection, and kindles in us to exercise the Christian virtues. So when is this grace imparted in us? Please listen. Out of His mercies, out of His kindness, He gives, He exerts an influence in our soul, in our mindset, in our arguments, in our logic, in our thinking process, in our likes and in our dislikes, in my mindset. Mind is a battlefield. We got all our likes and dislikes, wants and desires, emotions, everything is in our soul. Our reasoning power is in the mind. Right, wrong. I want to do, I don't want to do. No, I want to obey. No, I don't like to do it. No, I like to do it. It's all in our mind. It's all in our mindset. All our arguments, logical thinking. So what is happening when He imparts this grace, His influence, a sweet influence in our soul, He turns us to Christ. Not your religion. I'm Christian. I'm Hindu. I worship in a particular way because I am born a Christian. I worship in another particular way because I am born a Hindu. I celebrate Diwali because I am born a Hindu. Now I celebrate Christmas because I am born a Christian. So it's a religion. It's a religion. As Krishna is for somebody a Lord, Christ is a Lord for somebody. As they are devoted to Ram or Krishna, some people are devoted to Christ. It's a religion. But when this grace is imparted in our soul, that way we are saved by grace. We are not turned to a religion, we turn to Christ. So after we received grace, after Jesus imparts grace in us, Christ is not just our Lord. He becomes my Lord. A personal decision. Without grace, we cannot come into this glorious experience of salvation. Please listen carefully. You can share this with others also. There's a beautiful novel by Dr. Rabindranath Tagore, Gore. Some of you may be knowing the story very well. I have said that one or two occasions earlier. There was a boy, Gore. Gore means white, Velayan. His name is Velayan. He's white, Gore. And his parents were Brahmins. He thought Brahmins are superior to all the other human beings. They are right from God. And all the others are not that privileged. And also he had a great spirit against the English people. He was fighting for India. And he wanted to kill many of the white people, the English people. But his father, a Brahmin, he was discouraging these two acts. Don't think that Brahmins are superior. You should not fight against the English people. You should not kill them. But the boy was very angry. My father, he doesn't have any respect for his caste. And he is not patriotic. He doesn't hate English people. The days were passing by. That old man was about to die. At that time he called Gore and told him the secret. Son, it was at the time of Sipahi mutiny. There was a great outbreak against the white people, English people, killing them wherever we could see them. There was a woman, a white woman, with the fullness of pregnancy, when she saw our doors are open, she rushed in. Fell down at the threshold. And she gave birth to a boy child and died. You are that white boy. By blood you are not a Brahmin. By nationality you are not an Indian. You are born in India in a Brahmin house. No one is a Christian because he or she is born in a Christian family. Had you born in a Hindu family or a Hindu or a Muslim? It's only a religion. There is a small jocular story. A cow gave birth to a calf in a cow shed. Immediately the calf stood up and said, "I am a car, I am a car." Others said, "No, you are not a car, you are only a calf." "No, no, I am not a calf, I am a car." Then they solaced that calf and said, "Why do you call yourself a car? You are only a calf." That calf said, "Because I am born in a car shed." Because I am born in a car shed. Because we are born in a car shed, we cannot become a car. A calf cannot become a car. But only when this grace is given to us, what is this? The first act of this grace turns us to God. I was born in a Christian family, very orthodox Christian family, exemplary Christian family, with a lot of Christian values. Many a time I used to be afraid that I have not given those Christian values to our children. I have never seen my father and mother ever quarreled with each other. Never seen. Not once. We go to church together. We go to movie together. Very loving family. And I've seen my brothers and sisters, you know, fighting or arguing. Not even one day I can imagine ever there was an argument between the sisters and brothers. Not one day. Why do I say this? Not to brag about our family background. But this is the background. But only when I was 21, I came to Christ. As a child I was baptized. When I was in standard 11, presently plus one, in our church order I took confirmation. I attended a Sunday school. When I was in standard 11, that was plus one, I became a VBS teacher. But only when I was 21, I came into Christ. This salvation experience came. I took Jesus as my personal Savior. I was born again. This is the work of grace. This is the work of grace. The first thing what grace does in our life, it separates us from religion and it takes us to a person, Christ. For me, it's not the religion, it's not the doctrines of the church, not the doctrines, a Muslim would say the Jamaat. It's not the doctrines of my parish. I turn to Christ. I turn to the teachings of Christ. So, grace turns us to Christ and it keeps them in Christ. It strengthens them in Christ. It makes us increase, it increases in us in Christian faith. More and more I understand Christ. More and more I love Christ. More and more I understand His word. It makes me increase in faith, in knowledge and in affection, and it kindles in us to the exercise of the Christian virtues. Some people may have Christian virtues by nature. The other day one gentleman came to me. He was talking to me about his Hindu friend. He said, other than baptism, what he meant, other than receiving Christ as his personal Savior, he is a Christian in every virtue. Many good people are there. But more and more when we grow in grace, more and more we embrace Christian virtues. That's our strength. We love our parents. We love our co-bonds, we love our wives, we love our children, we love our friends, we love strangers, we love our enemies. We grow in Christian way. More and more you grow in grace, more and more you'll grow in Christian virtues. If somebody cannot grow in Christian virtues, he is not in grace, he has fallen from the grace. He is not in grace, he has fallen from the grace. So Christian grace turns us, the grace given to us, turns us to Christ and keeps us, strengthens us, increases us in Christian faith, knowledge and affection, and kindles in us to exercise of the Christian virtues, causing and costing its reflection in every part of our life and behavior. Soul affects our behavior. From the word soul, we get the Greek word for soul is psyche. From that only we get the word psychology, psychotric, psychiatrist, psychic. It's from the word psyche. Even the subject psychology means is a study of our behavior. How do we know that He has imparted grace in us? It reflects in every part of our life and our behavior. The way we talk. The way you talk with your husband. If you can reflect the Christian virtue, you got grace. If you cannot exercise the Christian virtue in you, you don't have the grace. Or you have fallen from the grace. If you can exercise your Christian virtue towards your wife, you love her as yourself, you don't harbor any bitterness against her, you're able to exercise your Christian virtue, then you've got grace. That is seen in your behavior. Because grace is imparted in our soul. Grace is imparted in our soul. It affects our thinking process. I want to obey the word of God. I want to see what Jesus said. I want to obey what Jesus says. I don't have an argument on it. It's after salvation. We may have a very good religion without salvation also. But when we are saved, I don't want to see what my church tradition is. I want to see what the Bible says. Because I am delivered from the church tradition and turned to the Word of God. I am turned to the Word of God. That is the work of grace in my life. That's the work of grace in my life. From the church tradition, I love CSI. I love CSI. I am from CSI background. I learned a lot of Bible stories when I was in CSI. And I learned a lot of things which are wrong also from my CSI. The child baptism is not in the Bible, but that's in CSI. There is nothing called confirmation in the Bible, but that's in CSI. So I learned a lot of wrong things also when I was in CSA, and I was doing it very religiously. Very religiously. Can you see that? With my nature for worship of God, in my solistic way, had I been a Hindu, I might have followed that very meticulously. Friday I might have gone to the temple. Wherever I could see an idol, I might have removed my chappals. And I must have put topukarnam. And I must have come around and around that temple. I must have done it. I don't say it's wrong or right. But now I am delivered from the religion. More and more, I want to do what the Bible says. That's a simple difference. That's a simple difference. That is the work of grace. That is the work of grace. Before I wanted to do what my Jamaat, my Sabha said. But many people, the religion is the tradition of the church. I'm not against the tradition. Tradition we get from our ancestors. What they have received, they hand over to us. So I'm not against the tradition. But where the tradition is against the word of God, I differ. My dear brother, my dear sister, glory be to the Lord's holy. It's not the words. In a jocular way, I say, once I was in the Santam Cathedral, one Catholic mother came there from her dress and all I could see, she was a Catholic mother. Maybe seeing my face without this mustache and everything, I don't know what she could see on my face. She said, "Good afternoon, Father." I said, "Good afternoon, Mother." I'm a father, no doubt about it. She said, "From which parish?" I said, "Purasawalkam parish." I didn't know there was no parish in Purasawalkam. "From which parish?" I said, "Purasawalkam parish." She wondered, "Are you the founder of that parish?" I said, "Yes." "It's a parish. church, jamaat, sabha, they're only languages. Once we went to Thomas Mount and pastors from Karnataka, Chellikere pastors there with me, when I was taking them around that place, one novice sister, new sister, I don't know what they could see on my face. She came, knelt down before me and said, Father, bless me. I don't know how they bless. I don't know. But I just put my hand on her, I said, Lord, bless her and keep her in the path of truth. She also said Amen, I also said Amen. So we love them. There's nothing wrong in it. Please understand. But are we able to come from a religion to the Word of God? Religion to the Word of God. Catholic means fellowship. Even in the Apostolic Creed we say the Catholic. The Catholicity of the Church, the fellowship of the Church, is a sabbath, it's a fellowship. If you want to say Carmel Catholic, you can say instead of Carmel Christian Catholic, instead of saying Carmel Christian Assembly, you can say Carmel Christian Catholic. Nothing wrong in it. Instead of saying CCA, you can say Triple C. My dear brother, my dear sister, it's not the words. Turning to the Word of God. And the Christian virtues, not only saying that I'm a Pentecost, I'm a this CSI, no, I'm a Christian. More than a Christian, I'm a follower of Christ. In the Bible, nowhere he said you become a Christian. Did he say that become a Christian? No. Become a follower of Christ. Become a follower of Christ, follow Christ. You don't want to follow Christ, you don't want to follow His teachings, and you say that I am a Christian. It is rubbish. With all honor I say, it's rubbish. Jesus said, follow me. I imitate me. I love to follow Him, I love to follow His teachings. That is the sign of grace in us. That is the sign of grace in us. Causing and costing. It's reflection. The influence of grace in our soul is reflection in every part of our life and behavior. In every part of our life and behavior. See, somebody wants to take baptism, immersion baptism, and the Christian nature is not reflected in his life. The simple reason he doesn't have grace. Grace upon grace, grace upon grace. More grace we get, more we reflect Christ's nature in us. More grace we get, we love to have a behavior based on Bible. We'll have a behavior based on Bible. My dear brother, my dear sister, a very important passage I show to you and I conclude. What does this grace do in our life? When grace is imparted into our soul, I told you it turns us to Christ. What does this grace do in our life? You turn with me to Titus chapter 2 from verse 11 to 14. Titus chapter 2 from verse 11 to 14. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation. This grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. And when Jesus won the cross of Calvary, Gentiles were there, His disciples were there, the Jews, Pharisees, Sadducees, high priests, commoners, they were there. Romans were there, Greeks were there, Jews were there, soldiers were there, priests were there, commoners were there. So the grace of God, it's not just I'm talking about grace of God that bringeth salvation. Only this grace can bring salvation to mankind. Otherwise man can have only a religion. Please understand that part. Man can have a religion, it can be Christianity, Hinduism or Muslim, Parsis, Jainism, Buddhism, some religion. But man can have salvation only through grace, when God's grace is imparted, influence in our soul. So the grace of God that brings salvation hath appeared to all men. To his disciples, they see Jesus on the cross. They will have a reasoning. Jesus, who cannot save himself, how can he save us? He cannot save himself, how can he save us? They are scared. They ran away, they were hiding themselves. Because they are reasoning. If this could happen to Jesus, what worse could take place in us? They had their own reasoning, they got their own thinking, they got their own logic. What their logic did? Go hide yourself in an upper room. They are hiding. They didn't even want to bury the body of Jesus Christ. The grace appeared unto them. The grace appeared unto the religious people. That's a very big question. If Jesus is God, can man kill God? That's the philosophy of nature. Man killed God, so no God is there. There's no God. When we see the things around us, when we see our politics, when we see the violence, violence against the weaker people, violence against sex, the murder, the corruptions, pollutions. Nietzsche says, man killed God, there is no God now. If there is God, can these things happen? There's a philosophy of Nietzsche. So for the religious people, cross is a stumbling block. Cross is a stumbling block. Can God die like this? Can a man kill God? If God died, what will happen to us? And for the Romans, for the Gentile thinkers, oh, it's mad. He said he would save everybody. We thought he is the savior of mankind, he could not save himself. Ha 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 ha. The Bible says, they were laughing at him. The same word is used, ha 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 ha. They were mocking at him. The grace appeared unto all men. But all were not saved. Only you allow that grace to work in your life. Out of his mercies, out of his kindness, he wants to exert that grace in us. But the Lord has given a willpower in us, whether we can choose, a right to choose, whether I can allow that grace to work in me or my reason. You know, no, no. This cannot happen. I got my own Jewish religion, we got our own tradition, we got our temple, we got our temple services, we got our priests, we got our order of priests, we got our own services, we got our sacrifices, we got our religious system, we got festivals, we got Passover, we got Unleavened Bread Festival, we got the Festival of Trumpets. We got our own religion. Why should we go behind this bloody Jesus? With all respect, I use the word bloody Jesus. From that only we got that word bloody virgin. Soaked in blood. Head to toe. His visage so marred. When we could see him, there's no beauty in him. No comeliness in him. Bloody body. Why should I go behind him? I got my own religion. For the scoffers, it's a joke. A person who was against the religion, who was against the religious system, who was against that day's political system. Speaking against the practices of that religion. Calling himself the temple. And the end has come for him. They all got their reasonings. They all got their logics. And their logics are very sound. But the grace that could bring salvation to all men appeared unto all. Appeared unto all. Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, jealous of good works. A peculiar people, jealous of good works. My dear brother, my dear sister, this is one of the longest sentences in the Bible. Yesterday I was counting about 74 words. I may be wrong. I made a count of about 74 words in this one sentence, one of the longest sentences in the Bible. Does anyone here know what is the longest sentence in the Bible in English? Anybody knows? Okay, I leave this quiz to you. Next week you can tell me what is the longest sentence in the Bible. This is not the longest sentence in the Bible, but one of the passages is a very long sentence. It starts in verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, jealous of good work. So the very purpose of this grace that bringeth salvation unto all men, it is exerted in our soul. The very purpose is to make us a peculiar people, jealous for God. Jealous of good works, I'm sorry. To make us a peculiar people. The word peculiar today has got a different meaning. In the old English, peculiar means it is totally belonging to us. He walks in a peculiar way. He talks in a peculiar way. She dresses in a peculiar way. Only she can dress like that. Only he can walk like that. It's a peculiar. In the old English, peculiar people, only they can live like that. Only God's people can live like that. Only Bible-believing Christians can live like that. They're peculiar. They're peculiar people. If the people of the world, if they want to have a marriage in a particular way, every religion, they will have a particular way. Every religion will have it in a particular way. And in every religion, every caste, every sect, every race will have it in a particular way. But this group of people, they love to have it only in the Bible way. Peculiar people. When everybody does like this, these people, they want to do it like this. They want to do it like this. Everybody does it like that. Since the world calls us peculiar people, it's not wrong. We are Bible-believing people. I'm a Christian. I was a Christian. I was a CSA Christian. But now I know what is happening in the CSA church, where I was baptized, where I had my confirmation, etc. I'm really pained. I haven't become a Pentecostal Christian. I know what are the things happening in the Pentecostal churches also. But I want to be a peculiar person, the word literally meaning only belonging to God. Only God's people can be like this. Only God's people. We are peculiar unto Him. So the grace is given to us, teaching us every day to be a peculiar people, and this peculiar people jealous of good work. This is a sound doctrine. A very long sentence. What is the teaching of this grace? How could we become a peculiar people jealous for good works? If you read Titus chapter 2 from verse 1 to 10, it talks about our lifestyle. I don't have time to read everything. In verse 1, he says, "But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine." The things which would become sound doctrine. So this doctrine is not the baptism. This doctrine is not the seven sacraments. This doctrine is not our attachment with a parish or a church or a jamaat or a sabha. What is this sound doctrine? In verse 2 he says, how the aged women should behave. Mootha sthriyal eppadi nadakkanum. How a mother should behave. Aged mother, 60, 70. How should a mother behave? How should a mother-in-law behave? What should a mother teach her son, and what should he teach her daughter? If that mother has got grace, a mother in her 60s, Mootha Stri, aged woman, she knows what she tells her son, what she tells her daughter. That's grace. The people of the world may not have grace. Can you see? That's a sound doctrine. Sound doctrine is not in anything else. All those things are essential, but that should lead to behavior. And in verse 2, aged men. Verse 3, aged women. Verses 4 and 5, how should a young woman behave? How should a young woman behave? For aged men, one verse. Aged women, one verse. In verse 6, how a young man should behave. That's also one verse. I don't know why. Two verses are given for how a young woman should behave. And again, two verses are given for how a servant of God should behave. These two are delicate things. A young woman, a servant of God. How a servant of God should be. These things make us a peculiar people. A people zealous for good work. A young woman, an aged woman, a young man, an aged man, a servant of God. In the latter part of verse 8 he says, in all things, servants, in all things, servants of showing thyself a pattern of good works. He says, servants of God, in all these things, show thyself as a pattern of good works. And in verses 9 and 10, in one way or the other, we all are servants. We all are under some rule. So how should we behave in this world? How should we behave in this world? In that, he says, the grace of God teaching us what all we should do, what all we need not do. My dear brother, my dear sister, I want to come to that part, that's the main message, Titus chapter 2 from verse 11 to 14. The behavior of a peculiar people, jealous of good works, how should their behavior must be? God willing, I'll continue on that. But today the Spirit of the Lord has spoken to you. You should understand grace. Grace is a life of beauty. Grace is a life of charm. Grace is a life with charisma. The Lord wants to give this grace to make us more beautiful. And when this grace is exerted in us, the first thing, it turns us to Christ. It turns us to the Word of God. He is the Word. It turns us to Christ. When it turns us to Christ, this Word helps us grow in the knowledge of the Word, increase in His nature more and more. We are able to show forth His behavior, the work of grace in our behavior. We begin to show forth the work of grace in our behavior. So the grace has appeared unto all men. It's available for everybody at the cross of Calvary. At the cross of Calvary gives different reasonings, different logical thinking for different people. For the Jews, for the Gentiles, for the religious people, for the people of this worldly wisdom, philosophers. But when we allow that grace into us, that turns us to God, that turns us to the Word of God, that reflects in our life, that becomes our sound doctrine. We become a people peculiar. A people peculiar. A people given totally to the Word of God. To the worldly philosopher, irrational. You're going behind this Jesus. What can this Jesus do for you? You don't want to have a religion. You want to have Jesus. What can this Jesus do for you? You're peculiar. Our lifestyle is peculiar. We follow the fashions of the world. We know we are peculiar. We are peculiar. Our dressing is peculiar. For us, the world seems to be mad. And for the world, we seem to be mad. For your college mates, your classmates, your colleagues. To the world, it seems to be a mad. For us, they are mad. They are in darkness. The people are in utter darkness. We have got the joy. We have got the peace that passeth all understanding. We have got the hope of eternity. We have become a peculiar people. A few weeks back I told the church, we are peculiar people. We don't have one foot of land in our name, in our house, nor in a bank. We don't have a locker in a bank. We don't have anything to keep in the locker. Even in our house, we don't keep anything in lock. We don't have 1 gram of gold in our house. Are we not happy? Probably we are the happiest people. We are peculiar people. And we are jealous for good work. How could this be possible? How does this grace operate in us, through us and for us? God willing, we shall continue next week. Shall we just commit ourselves to this work of grace? We are saved by grace. We are kept by grace. we will be ushered into heaven by grace. Shall we pray? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you, O Lord. Thank you for the grace that you have given us, O Lord. Thank you for this sweet, glorious influence of grace in our lives, a grace that reveals Jesus in us, helps us to walk in the way of the Bible, O Lord. In your teachings, O Master God, not in the teachings of men, not in the traditions of men, not in the rudiments of the world, O Lord, but according to your word. Thank you for the light you are giving us, more and more. Though we, Lord, it's our desire to be a peculiar people, a people who got a zealous for good works. We thank you, we praise, we worship, we bless your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.